I'm Chris Richardson, and this is Not a Pipe Podcast. Today, it is my great pleasure to be speaking with Ian Reilly about his book, Media Hoaxing, The Yes Men and Utopian Politics. Ian is an assistant professor in the Department of Communication Studies at Mount Saint Vincent University. His book deals with humor, politics, civic engagement, media activism, and a host of really important and interesting things. If you're not familiar with The Yes Men, which is the focus of this book, you definitely need to YouTube them. They're an interesting, provocative group. There's multiple videos that you can find easily online. Maybe if you're driving, you should wait till you get home, but definitely check out The Yes Men as you're thinking about this, or maybe after you listen to this podcast, because it raises a whole host of interesting and provocative ideas, which of course Ian talks about in his book Media Hoaxing. Also, as always, Ian is kind enough to provide 5 book recommendations if you're interested in learning more about this topic or learning more about what he's been reading and interested in. Check that out at tinapp.org. Ian, thanks so much. Let me get right into it. Let's talk maybe about the Yes Men first. When did you discover them? When did you realize that they were going to be perhaps the focus of your book? I think this was a dissertation at first. And so at some point you must have had the thought that this will be the focus. How did that happen for you?
I think that the first time I encountered the Yes Men's work was in the fall of 2005. The University of Guelph, where I was a doctoral student, was hosting a regular documentary series, and they had screened the Yes Men's first documentary, which came out in 2003, I believe. I was blown away by it. I thought that I had never quite seen a group do work in this way. So they were doing activism, they were doing pranking, and they were doing it in the guise of progressive politics. And it really inspired me to think of how humor could be integrated into political action campaigns, activist politics and philosophy. And mostly I just thought it was incredibly funny. And I was given the opportunity to do TA work in some classes and having a lot of informal conversations with people who were just discovering them and realizing that there was an immediate interest in what they were doing. And I didn't really focus on them for another 2 years when it became clear that I could find a way of integrating what they were doing into my doctoral research. And so humor was the thread that allowed me to incorporate what they were doing into my dissertation, which was on fake news. So I guess the discovery in 2005 opened the possibility for me to think of their work more profoundly as I move through my PhD.
Maybe we can clarify a little bit for people, especially who aren't familiar with the Yes Men's work. The title of your book is Media Hoaxing. When you think about humor and satire, I think there are a lot of different ways that we can understand what you mean by fake news, by humor, by, well, protest and activism. And so where does this group fit in to that whole realm of humor and news and media?
Well, I think that first and foremost, they think of humor as being the most effective tool for either critiquing or subverting the most powerful institutions on the planet. And they want to use humor as a way of inspiring people to carry out activist work, political protest. So for them, satire is really about critiquing the powerful in such a way as to embarrass, shame, or ridicule them for not acting ethically in the world. And beyond that, I think that the humor piece, as far as their documentary work goes, they have 3 documentary films with a fourth coming, with their YouTube videos that have amassed an impressive following. I think that the humor piece is what attracts moviegoers, and the idea that they had originally hoped would be the lightning rod for people to go out and do activist work. If anyone can be funny, or if anyone can channel humor within the political sphere or within the activist realm, that's empowering. It isn't just political process or trying to lobby for new bills and new laws. We can take to the streets, we can do it humorously, we can laugh even when the consequences are grave and the stakes are high. But humor is not something that we're used to seeing within activist milieus. It's something that we're not used to seeing, certainly within political institutions. And I think that it's really inspiring to see groups that are trying to find ways of changing our views of how politics can be enacted, and that humor and satire as forms of critique can move the conversation forward. It doesn't necessarily lead to policy change, but it certainly opens the door of possibility that I think most of us are seeking.
Yeah, and in this kind of work, as you mentioned in the book, failure and success can mean very different things, because if you're trying to get a bill passed, success would seem to be getting the bill passed. And if you're trying to be a news organization, it seems like having a large circulation and people believe what you have to say is successful. But in this case, especially with the satirical moves that they're making and hoaxes, how do we think about, or how would you encourage people to think about success and failure in that realm?
Well, I mean, it really depends on what we're talking about. So if the goal is to create a documentary that will make people laugh, then you can look at their first documentary where they go around impersonating the WTO and see that they're doing some really funny stuff, you know, going around in a golden colored leotard that inflates into an enormous phallus and talking about the advantages of remote labor for corporate managers and seeing business as usual for global capitalism at the expense of workers and human rights. I don't know. So is the goal for us to think more critically and profoundly about the abuses of some of the most powerful institutions on the planet, like the WTO, where there are clear winners and losers? Or is it just about creating an apparatus for entertaining things to flicker on the screen long enough for it to disappear within the context of their body of work, which is now well over 20 years of consistent political action? I think that they have mixed views. Once upon a time, it would have been, how much traction can we get in mainstream media? I still do think that in terms of success, if you have a hoax and you are trying to embarrass the target to make them either reform their ways or have the public recognize the futility in asking them to do so, then there are limits to that. But obviously, for a long time, success meant getting traction in mainstream media. How many news publications will cover the story, and how many will push ideas of social justice that do not regularly make the rounds. So, for example, when the Yes Men impersonated Dow Chemical on BBC, the 20th anniversary of the Union Carbide disaster, they wanted to shame, embarrass, and ridicule the company for its inaction, but they also wanted to promote a progressive light, saying that finally a corporation will do the right thing. It will remediate the site. It will remediate all of the people that have been affected by this human tragedy, one of the greatest industrial disasters of the 20th century, and it will ask for greater accountability. So, for example, and I know that I'm zigging and zagging, and maybe what I should be doing is trying to give listeners a sense of what the Yes Men actually do. So maybe we can backtrack a little bit. But I do think that the success piece is roughly how much attention can be paid to social justice issues, and how much accountability can we ask for on the part of news media organizations and also the public at large?
Yeah, well, sure. Why don't you go into a little bit more depth about what it is about that BBC hoax that was so effective? Because for me, I wasn't aware of what they had done. But also, upon reading that, I thought that it is such a sort of brilliant idea to pretend to be an ethical company and therefore call out the actual company and make them either double down on their pretty obvious inability to take responsibility for this event, to this really tragic event, or maybe in other cases to change their ways. So yeah, maybe you could say a little bit about what actually happened in the BBC instance, but also why that's such an interesting and provocative model.
So the Yes Men had been thinking of finding a way to hold Dow Chemical to account, and they had tried for well over a year. I think the process that I describe in the book is well over 18 months to try to get some hoax in play. And so what they did was they eventually created a fake website that was purely satirical, essentially saying that Dow Chemical spawned the environmental movement when they attacked Rachel Carson and her book Silent Spring in the 1960s, and their product DDT was the source of inspiration for Rachel Carson to write that book, thereby funding the environmental movement. So at any rate, they created a website called Dow Ethics, and it was hilarious and satirical, very pointed at sort of management speak and ethical companies doing unethical things. And what they did was they put a contact number and an email, and a journalist, not vetting the website, thought that they were related to Dow Ethics Bureau or some wing of Dow's corporation involved with ethical action. They asked them for a request to appear on BBC for the 20th anniversary of the Union Carbide disaster in Bhopal, India. And they accepted. They were very excited. And then as they prepared to address a live television audience that would later garner 300 million people, they made some outlandish statements. And what they said was that Dow Chemical, which had recently purchased Union Carbide, the company that was responsible for the disaster, would ultimately be sold piecemeal in order to fund all of the remediating practices that they had planned. So they were going to remediate the site. They were going to fund research to ensure that no industrial accidents of this nature would happen again. And they would extradite the CEO who was responsible and at the helm of the company at the time. And they would pay for the medical bills of all of the people and families affected by the disaster.
Yeah, and this is a disaster that affected, was it hundreds of thousands of people in India, a chemical leak that ultimately basically devastated this area in the 80s. And nothing, if I'm correct about this, nothing had really been done other than basically a slap on the wrist. And so Dow bought that company, or did they own that company already?
Dow purchased Union Carbide, which was the company that was responsible. And I don't have the numbers in front of me, but sure, they're stated quite clearly in the book that they are in the dozens of thousands. And particularly if we're talking about not deaths necessarily, but those whose lives were affected for the duration of their lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so what was Dow's response to that? And why, well, in your opinion, was it an effective use of activist satirical media hoaxing? And if so, what made it effective?
Well, the group was instantly criticized by the BBC for the deception. They called it an elaborate deception. And obviously, the Yes Men have discussed this in the aftermath of the hoax, saying that they felt bad about having to rely on the BBC to be the mouthpiece for the deception, but it was their only play at the time. And of course, other journalists, but mostly Dow Chemical, openly denied that they were doing any such things because the price index of Dow Chemical and also Union Carbide dropped significantly as soon as this information was made public, that they were essentially going to liquidate the company. But the play ultimately worked because despite the fact that many could have made the argument that they were producing false hope for the victims in Bhopal, what they were doing was essentially reaffirming Dow Chemical's laissez-faire attitude towards resolving any of the problems that the former company was responsible for. And so really, it just made very clear that it was business as usual, and that even though Dow Chemical had settled many of the other litigation issues surrounding Union Carbide, they were unwilling to do any such activities in India.
Yeah, I think that can be read in some way as not successful because they didn't affect immediate change, or they didn't convince Dow to make changes. But I think in the book, if I read what you're saying, it is a really effective thing in other ways. Can you say a little bit more about how you feel about the goals and thinking or reflecting on these goals later?
Yeah. Well, I think for the group, it was a huge success. And in many ways, this has become a textbook example of how to hold corporations or powerful institutions accountable when they are seen to be acting unethically or when they are adopting laissez-faire policy or action. And this case study, the Bhopal hoax, has traveled far and wide. It is fairly well known within activist circles. It is fairly well known within performance art. It is fairly well known anecdotally from people who remember someone impersonating a corporation on the BBC that one time and making them look ridiculous and also embarrassing them for their inaction. Because this work also reappears in their documentary films, they're allowed to explore these issues in greater detail than the duration of the 3-minute video or the 2-minute video follow-up where the BBC essentially denounces them, where they're doing sort of the journalistic paradigm repair to ensure that their credibility is intact. But I do think that the successful piece was also not only reaching that many people to put this Bhopal tragedy into the mainstream for at least 2 weeks following the 20th anniversary, which may never have happened if they hadn't orchestrated this ethical spectacle. That's a term that I've adopted from Stephen Duncombe's work. And the ethical spectacle is just allowing for issues that would not be making the rounds. And so the BBC clearly wanted to bring this discussion to the fore. They probably got more than what they had anticipated. And it's nothing that a journalist would wish to see them be deceived or hoaxed in any way. Mm-hmm. But it certainly pushed the Bhopal tragedy to greater lengths and in it to a more global context. And beyond that, I would say the successful piece for the Yes Men is that it really put them on the map as a group to watch. And many of these ideas and issues would resurface in their second film. And I think that they gained a great deal of momentum. And they probably also learned that if you put a target in what they call a decision dilemma, where in essence, you are damned if you do and you are damned if you don't, then it presents an interesting angle for us to consider how corporations function or act in the world. And I think they really forced Dow Chemical's hand in having to respond either in a way that would embarrass them or in a way that would lay it all very clearly to the world that they were not going to act in any fashion on this topic because they just wanted to see this go away. And I think that the fact that they didn't take legal action shows just how much they did not want this to be at the forefront of their activities. They tried to make this go away. And by offering a very curt response and not moving it any further, they tried to deflect as much responsibility or visibility as possible.
Yeah, I want to ask then about the sort of political positions of the Yes Men and groups that have been maybe inspired by them and probably groups that have inspired them. A lot of this seems to come from the sort of progressive movement. I mean, it's hard to say like how exactly to lump a bunch of people together, but you could say critics of capitalism, neoliberalism, and people concerned with social justice. So roughly speaking, left activists. Mm-hmm. It doesn't seem to work or it doesn't seem to be a strategy that the right employs. I remember seeing a few examples of people trying to sort of mimic the old Stephen Colbert report and these kinds of things on the right, and it just doesn't seem to work very well. Do you think that's inherent? I mean, you do talk a little bit in the book about the politics behind the Yes Men, but I'm wondering if you see this as somehow linked, this kind of satire or hoaxing, to a left, or is it just simply different on the right? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, you're raising some really interesting questions because I do think that there is something inherent about activists or satirists or humorists on the left to use those tools and tactics because it's a mode of critique that is well established. And if all targets are available and ready to be scrutinized, then it just means that there's no shortage of material. So, for example, when Obama was voted into the presidency, the question became, will satirical or parodic work die? And the answer is no. It's a resounding no. You know, human folly is everywhere. And it just means that we may have to pivot or redirect our energies towards the targets that are doing the worst things, right? And so what I think we're seeing is that the right is using some of the tactics that are inherent in the circulation of what I don't want to call hoaxing, but I do want to call disinformation, misinformation, and fake news or propaganda. But I do think that there is an element of trolling on the right that we've seen that continues to proliferate. And they're trying to use some of the tactics that are being employed by progressive activists like the Yes Men, which is to say that we can create our own fake news and circulate ridiculous stories that make liberal candidates or left-wing candidates seem unethical, embarrassing, ridiculous, shameful, all of these things. And I think that we've seen that also on the right. It just may not have the same humorous savvy that we see with the likes of Stephen Colbert and Jon Stewart or the Yes Men, who happen to be legitimately funny. So yeah, I do think that there are differences, but I do think that one of the things that came up recently based on a talk that I gave on the book was that the right is engaging in this kind of trolling, and it almost in certain ways is indistinct from some of the activities that the Yes Men have participated in. It's just that the divide between those two groups and those two sides is so great that we don't see them as operating on the same level. And yet I do think that there's a real ethical divide, and that the compass that is used to measure ethical activities is completely different, and it's distorted and upside down.
Yeah, well, I want to push you a little further on that then. You don't make the comparison, but you mentioned how people were upset with Facebook, of course, after the 2016 election in particular, because it seemed afterward, and it could be that Facebook is very, very responsible for the election of Trump, or it could be that it's sort of a scapegoat for a much larger cultural issue, but it did seem like they and other social media platforms made it very easy to put out fake news and potentially hoaxes, if you want to call them that, mm-hmm. that led to people being either confused or just siding very strongly with a candidate that they might not have otherwise. And so all of these issues came about. But I think it wouldn't be in good form to say that the Yes Men are equivalent to fake news on Facebook, for example. And so what is the difference, or is there a difference between what people are really seeming to vilify and complain about, which is the just massive amounts of fake news that people are sharing on Twitter and Facebook, versus an orchestrated hoax like the BBC one you mentioned, where there seems to be a goal of having a corporation acknowledge something by creating, I guess that would be fake news. I mean, the fact that they're pretending to be a corporate representative, but it also seems different than what people are usually talking about when they mention fake news in today's discourses.
Well, I think the first thing that I would say is that there are elaborate deceptions that exist, and we have to think about why those articles, those pieces of information are circulating. And I think that many of the instances that we were seeing in the 2016 election, and there really has been a deluge of false information that we've seen since then, circulating on platforms like Facebook, for example, that we have to be careful about the motives and the motivations behind doing this kind of work. And in many ways, it's just to create confusion and to discredit certain views over others, certain figures over others, certain movements over others. And it isn't honest, it isn't ethical, and there's a great deal of lack of integrity on the part of the people that do this work. For a group like the Yes Men, I still think that the work is ideologically motivated, but we have to be clear about the fact that when they are performing the hoax, when they are creating deceptions, they're doing so with the intent to reveal what it is that they're doing. And so in the book, I call these welcome deceptions, because we are fooled just for a moment. And the long trajectory of the work they've done, they discovered quickly that it was better for them to deceive and then to reveal, or to fool and to reveal quickly, so that the gap between when they hoaxed you and when they told you that you were being hoaxed was short, so they could then make a point to tell you what they really wanted to say. And there's a difference between circulating false information and never revealing it as false information, and just allowing it to circulate freely in the world and never to be found as anything more than fake news or propaganda. But this group has made a point of inscribing that into the work that they do. And the reveal is meant to produce a kind of pleasure where you can think, oh, you had to do all of these elaborate things just to get a foothold in mainstream news media, because they don't want to report on these issues. But you were clever about it. And now that you've told us that you've deceived us, can you tell us what the point was? And often the point is to espouse some sort of progressive view about how we should be living, which is where I really get into the idea of utopian politics, which is mostly refusing the current moment or the elaboration of the current moment and thinking about how we could build a better world. And those are some of the powerful instances. So if you couple this idea presenting false information that will then be revealed to you as false information with a purpose. And the purpose is to inspire or reactivate the collective political imagination about what we can do and how we can lead our lives. Then I think that most people, at least in the court of public opinion, we aren't going to think that you are doing destructive things in the world, but rather that you are trying to get us to think differently in a moment where polarization might actually be splitting us apart, not allowing us to imagine how we might link up our ideas to do interesting things.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great elaboration on the differences, because I think there are definite differences, as you mentioned, between the kind of work they're doing and the kind of work that's widely condemned, I think, by pretty much everybody in terms of fake news.
Can I give you a good example of what they did? So, for example, Shell, big energy company or big oil company, mm-hmm. I don't know what we're calling them these days, but Shell was planning to begin some very big oil extraction endeavors in the Arctic. And none of this work was well publicized, not even by journalists. The Guardian may have had an article or two, but it was not well known. And so the Yes Men partnered with Greenpeace, and they created a huge media splash, which became an 18-month project. And what they did was they created a kickoff celebration of the news that Shell would be drilling in the Arctic. And they created a whole event where it was in the Space Needle in Seattle, a very swanky area, very swanky event with a bunch of Shell executives celebrating their soon-to-be success and their excitement. Let's go. Let's go to the Arctic. We're really pumped. We're really excited. And they had a Kulik, which was the old extraction device that was used, which was also found to be an environmental hazard. So they used that as a prop at this party that would then dispense some kind of drink or some kind of cola. And symbolically, there was a problem with the Kulik, and then all of the cola-colored drink went everywhere, mm-hmm. would be the polar ice caps or whatnot, creating real havoc. And the argument there was just that if we don't get this right, then the environment suffers and all of the species in the Arctic will suffer. So they made a point of creating a viral video that then was seen far and wide, that was commented on across news media, to make a point that we should be paying attention to what we do in the environment. They have been very strong on climate change and the environment for well over a decade. And so a partnership with Greenpeace allowed them to create this sort of ethical spectacle that went far and wide. But mostly, I think what was really powerful was that they publicized the story that was not anywhere to be found. And since then, I think that there's a lot more awareness about these sort of drilling activities that are being proposed in the Arctic. And we're far more aware of this. And 18 months later, for a number of reasons that I get into in the book, Shell had to withdraw its drilling operations. So we can't credit the Yes Men or Greenpeace for this, but it was part of a concerted effort to ensure that there was visibility for this issue and this topic, that it was complex, and that maybe it wasn't the best idea in the first place for us to be doing this. And yet, as soon as Shell had to withdraw, they then partnered with a Russian big oil company, Gazprom, and they attempted to do the same because they escaped other jurisdictions. So the story is ongoing, and the need to intervene is always there. But I think what this example shows is that even the idea of creating a false spectacle is not something that Shell created on their own behalf. They just wanted to continue business as usual. But the Yes Men wanted to publicize the fact this was going on and create visibility for something that people weren't aware of. Myself, I was not aware of this until this hoax made it into my Twitter stream, for example.
Well, and that's definitely the sort of media ecology that we're dealing with now, is that, I mean, everyone that studies media, I think, is sort of aware that ongoing deep-seated issues do not get the kind of coverage that something visually interesting will do, like this sort of fake oil spill event. So these can be very powerful. It made me actually think a little bit. It's funny, while I was reading your book, I was thinking for a second, you know, we planned to talk and we had met and spoken already, but as I was reading more and more of the Yes Men, I thought for a second, like, what if Ian is just trying to hoax me? Like, what if he is trying to, I don't know, expose something about the podcast or about academia or something like that? Or what if his book is secretly, like, fake somehow, and it's just asking people how closely they're paying attention to it? And it just made me think that these are really interesting ways in which we start considering things like drilling in the Arctic or compensating people who have been devastated by chemical spills. But is there a sense that like there's an appropriate amount of hoaxing or an appropriate amount of satire? And should there be a safe space from hoaxing, do you think?
It's a good question. The first point I want to make is, am I hoaxing you or academia or whatnot? Maybe. I mean, if you get to that level, it's really matrixy or inception-y. And I think that I would prefer not to go that way because there are too many layers and that would make my book a lot more complex than it actually is. But how much hoaxing? Well, and actually, before I move on, I would say that this is a question that I've considered myself because the Yes Men begin their careers as activists, in a sense, as presenters at conferences. The first conference they gave was in Salzburg, and they were impersonating the WTO. And they did a number of these conferences. One of the great conferences they delivered was in Australia to a group of chartered accountants, and they dissolved the WTO. I mean, how can you not be inspired to think differently of conferences when you've seen this model, right? So there are examples of academic parody at conferences. I haven't unearthed that history yet, but it would be a fun one to explore. Beyond that, I would also say that there is room to do hoaxing within academia. This is something that I have explored recently in an article that I'm hoping to publish very soon. And that is about whether or not hoaxing is appropriate to academic publishing, because there was a real shitstorm in the fall of 2018 when a group of scholars hoaxed a bunch of cultural studies journals. Mm-hmm. And I can come back to that if you would like later. But the question around whether or not there's an appropriate amount of hoaxing in the world, I think that it's a real case-by-case basis. Ultimately, I think that it's nice to consider what tools are most effective at what times. And I think that this is a real contribution that the Yes have made through their storied history by collaborating with other groups like the Yes Lab organization that they founded. They've collaborated on 40 or more projects in a very short time. And I think what they've done is they've really tried to figure out which tools are most appropriate in putting forward a particular campaign or a particular set of goals that they have. And hoaxing is not always, and it is never really, the default way of engaging in activist work. It is one of many tools. There are many tools that were very successful in the 1950s and 1960s. They remain strong to this day. I just participated in a 500,000 person march in Montreal for the climate strike. So clearly there are different levers to be used at different times within activist movements, within social movements, and hoaxing is but one. Do I think there's an appropriate limit? Yes, I don't think that we should be seeing hoaxes every week. I think that there is real fatigue for certain things, and not all humor will engage people and in fact can create greater rifts or divides and even cynicism amongst people who want to see more sincerity in the world, who want to see more earnest behavior. And I think that we should try to use as many tools as are available that will serve whatever projects or outcomes we are hoping to achieve. So do I have an answer? A flaky one, I guess.
Yeah, well, I did exactly want to talk to you about the academic hoaxes that have gone on, that have been publicized, and maybe there are some that haven't quite yet been publicized. And I don't know, maybe there'll be more, maybe there'll be less as things go and as we see what happens with certain controversial issues that are going on in academia. But like, yeah, I was reading the book and I was thinking about those conferences and I was thinking if an academic in some kind of appropriate way was to start talking about, I don't know, management or fashion, and then were to gradually go into, as the Yes Men did, this like giant blow up phallus outfit, I really do try to think about what I would do, because I'm sure I would laugh, I'm sure I would not take this person seriously. But at the same time, we've all seen sort of the studies on conformity and the studies on basically reacting, and if there were enough people in the room that were part of this hoax or whatever, it might be tempting to say I would be skeptical, but then not actually be skeptical in these moments. But yeah, so that said, it made me think like that would be funny and that would be good because it would wake people up and it would make sure that they are basically paying attention and listening. So in other words, if I thought someone was going to hoax me at a conference, I think in some ways that would be good because I would then be on my toes. Like I would be paying more attention and hopefully think more critically about what was being said, which would be a good thing. But some of the things that I've been seeing, I mean, there was the Sokol hoax where Alan Sokol was doing basically this like gobbledygook terminology in 1996 and exposed, or depending on who you talk to, right, exposed people for using these sort of postmodern terms without any real meaning. And then more recently, Peter Boghossian, you know, was found to have done this and did a paper, I believe. But in this case, though, yeah, without knowing enough about it to really comment, all I've seen is a few articles, and he's talking about canine rape culture and queer performativity. And so he's taking things that I think are fairly serious. Well, they definitely are serious. Rape culture, sexuality, and identity. And then I guess the hoax is that saying that dogs are doing this, and therefore that's preposterous, and therefore it shouldn't be published, but it was, and therefore these journals are not serious. But for some reason, the giant phallus management thing that the Yes Men did, I seem to have no problem with. This I seem to have, just intuitively, a big problem with. How do you negotiate? How do you weigh these different things? Are they part of the same spectrum, or do they clearly, I don't know, violate something that the other doesn't?
Right. Well, I do think that it is all about the violation of norms. And I think that the Yes Men tried really hard in the early days to shock their audiences out of their complacency and found that, no, everyone sort of accepted that the outlandish ideas that they were presenting were fine, or that they were too powerful an institution to openly criticize or critique. For example, they presented themselves at a conference on risk management, and they were presenting a new technology for Halliburton, and it was called the Survival Ball, which is essentially an amoeba-like orb that you wear. And in the event of catastrophic climate change, you would be able to survive in your what they called gated community of one and still perform your duties as a corporate manager. So the capitalist classes would continue unabated even in the face of climate change. And they just said, you know, if we have this, then we can continue to thrive. And it takes into account that the 0.00001% can afford to, I don't know, weather the coming catastrophes of climate change. And they did this, and they presented this to a group of, I don't know, business professionals and corporate managers and whatnot. And everyone seemed to like the idea. And they wondered if it had a broader applicability for things that they were doing. And they just thought, this is outlandish. This is crazy. Why does no one see this as hugely problematic? And it makes for great comedy because of the way that they do it, the way that they shoot it, and the way that they integrate it into their documentary. But it's also hugely problematic when people see this and they think, oh yeah, we could easily do this. We have a wing of our company that could do the research and development and then, you know, produce this product. You know, how marketable is this? How much per unit? And who gets to suit up in these things? They even asked people at the conference to suit up into these things. So I think there's obviously a breach of protocol. There's a breach of expectations, conventions, and norms. And in this context, no one's really coming away being harmed. But I do think that in the world of academic publishing, that there are ethical principles that are enshrined in the peer review process. It is unpaid labor, and we're asked to review articles in the hopes of improving them, to make them better. And we trust that the people who are submitting their work are being credible. They are ethical in the work that they're producing, and that we are not being fooled in any way. The editors work under this logic. The reviewers certainly operate under this logic. And when you've been fooled in this way, then it creates a breach of trust and credibility. And, you know, many have called this academic misconduct. So I do think that there are ways of presenting parity within the academy, but I'm not sure that peer review is the right place for it. I'm still thinking about this question of how appropriate parody is or hoaxing is within the realm of academia. So, for example, in 2018, a University of Victoria professor who is also an editor at a journal was reading about the argument that colonialism should be reinscribe that it is a boon to society and culture and that colonialism is a good thing. And so this created a real furor in the academic community. Two major petitions went out to have the article retracted from the journal. And so the University of Victoria professor, whose name I'm forgetting at the moment, decided to conduct his own ethical hoaxing experiment to then go out and find the editors that approved the publication of this article that was for colonialism and to see whether or not they would be interested in publishing a special issue on genocide and the advantages of genocide. I hope that I'm getting this right. This is the genocide hoax. And it was surprising that only one of the eight editors that responded said that this was morally appalling. And the argument there was that you can do a hoax in this capacity, but no names are revealed. We just want to know how people acted within this context. It wasn't produced as knowledge in the peer review sense, but it was certainly enlightening and illuminating of some of the different views and mindsets of people who are occupying important positions at various journals. And it's an experiment that doesn't need to shame anyone directly, embarrass anyone directly. But if we read it and we see it, then we understand that there is some work to do and that we all have blind spots that need to be understood and also hopefully addressed or discussed out in the open publicly. Yeah, so I think that that's one example of when hoaxing can be ethical.
Yeah, well, it makes me think, like you said, exposing blind spots in most cases that I can imagine is a good thing because then you realize certain vulnerabilities, especially if no one's harmed in exposing those vulnerabilities. Mm. But it makes me think, what is actually being exposed? Because I think in the academic hoaxing and some of the ones that become high profile, what I think is actually being exposed is the precarious labor, as you mentioned, of people who are in their free time, which a lot of academics don't really have, are reading these things for free and trying to help the journal or help the author improve whatever it is that they're writing about or studying. And so what you're probably finding in terms of a blind spot is the incredible lack of funding and resources and time that many academics have. And therefore, you're really just exposing probably an early assistant professor stressed out of his or her mind who didn't have time to thoroughly vet something that they weren't being paid for or what have you. It didn't actually expose what I think the authors were trying to expose, which is the sort of coded language of postmodern thinkers or something like that. And so that made me think about what you were saying about earlier, giving a talk on your book and having a wide interest, at least in your experience and in your thoughts on the precarious labor situation involved in writing this and in working on similar activist projects. Maybe you could say a little bit about that experience. I think it was a talk you said at University of Toronto.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that I began my talk with was that we don't often talk about the academic labor that goes into a book project. Mm-hmm. Because we like the idea of the completed book, the book that you can then shop around at conferences, that you can then show to the world and hopefully present to a wider public. But for me, the book really began in 2011, a year after I had finished my PhD. And I didn't want to work on my fake news dissertation, but I was very interested in what the Yes Men were doing. And so I thought maybe there is an opportunity here for me to write a book on this group. And I thought that the only way to do justice to the topic would be to write a popular press book or a trade publication book. And so I met with a couple of editors that I had known in Toronto, and I had an informal agreement with a major publishing house in Canada. And for roughly the first 6 to 12 months, it was assumed that there was a book project on the table and that I was going to start writing it as a sort of trade publication or a popular press book. And very soon after that, the editor that I was collaborating with left the company and disappeared. I did not have a contract in hand, so that project just sort of disappeared because I did not have a literary agent and I did not have anyone to open doors. So there was an issue around all of the work that I had done initially to produce a particular kind of book for a particular kind of audience, and then not finding a way to find a place for it. So I then decided to shelve it for a little bit. And I think maybe a year went by. And then I got a grant as part of being a sessional instructor at the University of Guelph Humber in Toronto. I hired two undergraduate assistants who helped me work on the initial research. And then a couple of years go by and I'm at a different institution. I'm at Concordia University in Montreal. And I'm also without a book contract for most of this period. I'm working on the book and I end up rewriting it as an academic text because it makes more sense within that context. And it takes me a long time to get a book contract. But by the time I get the book contract, I realize that there's serious flaws in the way that I designed the book. So it feels that there were about two or three instances where I had a series of false starts and I had to continue to change and modify the template. I had three different chapters that were the core of the book. Those were completely redesigned in such a way that I don't really recognize the early drafts of the book. But the book contract was a real boon, but it's something that I probably should have done straight out the gate. So if I had any advice for junior faculty members or graduate students that are looking to produce a book manuscript, I think that the first thing that you would want to do is to meet with a publisher and try to get a book contract before you set out on any of the challenging work ahead. Now, that in mind, during this period, I think in the acknowledgments of the book, I write that the book was conceived of in three different cities, in Toronto, Montreal, and completed in Halifax. So there's a great deal of precarity during this time. I finished my PhD in 2010, and for 2 years I worked as a sessional instructor. I then got a three-year appointment at Concordia University in the Communications Studies Department. I also spent 1 year in full-on precarity mode, collecting employment insurance, thinking that I was going to leave academia because the academic job market in Canada in particular was not favorable to anyone. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't able to get a job. In 2016, I was lucky. And just as I was leaving academia, I found a tenure track position at Mount Saint Vincent University in Halifax. And then that's sort of when I was able to get the infrastructure needed to complete the project. I got a final grant from the university. I was able to hire another graduate student to help me do some of the final research that I needed to complete the book. But it was a very long and lengthy process. And a comedy of errors now that it's done, it's in the can, but I would have proceeded differently. And on a second book project, I would definitely choose a different tack. But again, these are all sort of invisible forms of labor within the academy. So there's sort of front stage, backstage. And I think the front stage part is the feel good part because you have the book in hand and you can bring it to places and you can discuss the ideas within. And you can see that there are limitations and shortcomings, but that you have something for the fruits of your labor. Mm-hmm. But the background is also that it is fraught with all kinds of precarity and challenges of securing employment, securing funding, getting book contracts. And there's a vulnerability in that. And I think that most of the people that participate in the writing of books are obviously not doing it for the money. They're not doing it for the fame. They're just doing it because they are passionate about their areas of research and they want to make contributions in the world. So I do think that the background, and this again connects to this notion of peer review and all of the unpaid forms of labor that sessional instructors carry out, that, you know, everyone within the institution carries out either as a service component or as a labor of love.
I mean, that's a great illustration of how it can be for many people. I mean, myself included, I from Toronto, but ended up working in rural Georgia because that's where I could find a tenure track position. And, you know, in many ways, I'm quite lucky and you're lucky to have this position. But in other ways, yeah, we can see a lot of the ways people are either put in precarious situations or asked to choose in some sense between a love of a craft versus a different kind of position, and holding out can be really hard. It made me also think that about basically what it is that I'm looking for in this podcast, really, which is, you know, the basic premise that I've established is that I talk to people about their books because these are usually years and years of experience that go into these things. And therefore, the stories behind them are often really interesting and informative, especially if somebody listening is looking to publish their own work. It also seems like a sort of catch-22 where I know in many cases, if you're trying to get a book contract, publishers want to know how your last book did, or they want to know that you are capable of writing books and therefore what was the last book you did. And so it can be very challenging to get that first book contract, especially if you don't have the book already. But then the second book seems to be a lot easier, especially if you've had success in the first. What would you do differently specifically?
Well, I think that I would really make sure that the work that I am setting out to do is something that I'm passionate about. Mm-hmm. And I want to share this work with the world, regardless of what the outcomes are. And those two don't often go hand in hand. So I think that that's one thing that I would really want to think about. Do I really want to spend the next 2 to 5 years of my life working on this project? And if the answer is yes, then I would try to find a publisher or a group of publishers that you think are appropriate for the work that you want to do, and look at the proposal guidelines for what they are asking for, and try to submit a book proposal to any of the publishing houses or presses that you think are worth your time. Another great strategy is to go to a conference if you have the means, and to meet all the editors that are on hand. Those conversations are really great. They're usually a lovely group, and they love to talk books, they love to talk ideas, and they legitimately care about the work that you're doing. And that's really powerful, and that's a good start. And also just trying to figure out whether or not there is some sort of relationship that can be built between yourself, the press, and the editor that you might like to correspond with and work with. I think those are the nuts and bolts. And beyond that, I think there are ways of trying to build an apparatus around the book. So try to find ways of including people that are around you, either informally or formally, by way of reading groups, informal or formal monthly or bi-monthly presentations of work that is being produced, and, you know, sharing drafts of the material either to a larger audience or to a smaller group of trusted people. There's no wrong way to do it aside from maybe the way that I did it. And even then, I think that there's a charm in figuring out what you did poorly and how to do it better the next time.
Yeah. Yeah, that's, I think, some sound advice. And it's important, I think, to question or to think about, I guess, the idea of a book being a sole commitment by the author, but also a communal sort of activity where people can get together and talk either before, during, or after the writing process. And obviously, you want people to read it, and so you want it to be a collective sort of experience, but it also can be very isolating in many cases. And so, yeah, that's a lot to think about. But is there any desire, after doing this work and seeing the Yes Men and participating in some of their activities, is there a desire to write a book or to get a book proposal or something to that effect as a hoax?
Well, I...
Again, if you can't share trade secrets, it's okay. Maybe I'll find out a few years from now that I really was hoaxed, or that your next book is a hoax. But no, have you had a desire for that?
Not really, no. I think that I'm ready to either write a companion book on hoaxing, which is a real possibility. I like humor. I think that humor is an important piece of my everyday life. And I don't know that I want hoaxing to take over my life. And I don't know that I want it to be that much of a mainstay, which is why it's nice to have different projects on the go. I am contemplating a second book on hoaxing, but from a range of different cultural practices and a range of different actors and creators. So that might be something. And that's as far as I can take it. I don't know that I will ever hoax anyone, maybe in a classroom setting where I want the students to have a real takeaway that can only be delivered in that format. And who knows, maybe that'll happen. That's what happened with me and my PhD supervisor, who sent me Horace Minor's Body Ritual Among the Nasarima article from 1956. And I was duped. And that became the foundation of my dissertation work, which was around false discourse and ultimately fake news. So you just never know when hoaxes will strike, but they can be really generative and they can lead you to ideas that will influence how you spend your time.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. I think the only time that I'm aware of being really hoaxed in a class was when I was doing this pedagogy workshop, and the professor, who's a really great professor of psychology, I can't remember his name right now because I never had him as a professor, but he was giving this talk and somebody was just getting really angry at him in the audience. They started fighting to the point where they basically started to like physically fight each other or write about. And then they broke down their characters and explained that this is actually how to manage disruptive students. And what you just saw is how not to do it and blah, blah, blah. And so it's interesting because that has to have been like 12 years or more. And I still remember that fairly vividly. Of course, you can't do that in every classroom or every experience, but definitely when you, those social norms have been broken down, there's room for learning and growing. And that's one of the things I think your book is so powerful about bringing out, is thinking more in depth and with nuance about those opportunities. I really appreciate you talking to me today, Ian. It was really interesting.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate you taking the time, and I look forward to seeing the next range of podcast books that come out of this podcast.
Thanks. I appreciate it. As always, thank you very much for listening to and supporting This Is Not a Pipe podcast. Be sure to check us out on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and wherever you're listening to this podcast from, whether it's iTunes, Spotify, YouTube, or what have you. Positive reviews, endorsements, all those kinds of things are always greatly appreciated. And be sure to check out tinapp.org as well, where you can see what authors have recommended as their 5 readings on each of their profiles on the website. Until next time, I'm Chris Richardson. Cheers.